I can't tell how many robots and how many real people are out there, but from everything I've been hearing, it sounds like we probably need a mix of both to be able to make sense of a very complicated set of problems. Can I ask how many people have heard of Verily? Is that, that's a word, okay. It's a new company, started, launched a little over a year ago. It used to be Google Life Sciences, and now we're off on our own and trying to look at a bunch of different healthcare areas, diabetes, heart disease, cancer, and CNS as well. And that's pretty much what I'm gonna focus on in the next half hour or so. I wanna do something which I probably should never do, which is to show a long quote at the outset and provide a little bit of a quiz. If you could read this, I want you to tell me who said it. And I'll give you a hint, this wasn't from Twitter. Any guesses? Anybody?
Previous guy.
The previous guy?
Yeah.
Obama?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it's a great guess, but you're off by about 50 years. This was actually almost exactly on this day in 1963, and it was part of a launch of the mental health program in the 1960s from President Kennedy. And what is astounding about this quote, besides the fact that it reminds you that presidents can actually be eloquent, is that this is equally true today, over 50 years later. And I wanted to just quickly take you through the data to support my statement that after five decades, we still are looking at a set of problems that create such incredible suffering as well as more financial drain on the treasury. Now, this is the data from a study of morbidity and mortality, an attempt to understand the burden of disease, and it's done by looking at premature mortality and the amount of morbidity for 291 different conditions worldwide. These are the US data, but as you can see, neuropsychiatric disorders, much to most people's surprise, actually outpace heart disease and cancer as sources of what are called DALYs, disability-adjusted life years, simply a metric of putting together mortality and morbidity. And part of the reason why that's surprising to people is they tend not to think about depression or bipolar disorder or schizophrenia or in this case even Parkinson's as diseases that would be as serious or create as much disability as heart disease or cancer. But in fact, they do, and what makes them different from heart disease, cancer, diabetes, and all these other sources is that they start early in life. So these are taking the same data, again, US data, and mapping them across decades of life. And what you can see is really for the first half of life, before age 45, being generous here, what almost virtually all the disability is going to be accounted for by this group of disorders. So these are essentially the chronic disorders of young people in the United States. We don't tend to recognize that when we think about these illnesses, but that is one of the things that really sets them apart from heart disease and cancer, which tend to be disorders of the second half of life. Now, what's interesting is it's not just a question of morbidity, but mortality as well. So suicide, we think about 90% of the time is related to having some form of mental illness. And you can see that if you look, and we could take this number back even to the 1960s and 70s, there's been a remarkable lack of change in the incidence of suicide in the United States. Roughly 12 per 100,000. And a couple of things about that are really striking to me. One is that you can see homicide, by contrast, has come down quite remarkably. You tend to hear an awful lot about violence in America, particularly gun violence, but actually most gun violence is self-directed, not other-directed. 52% of suicides are due to firearms. And so if you just run the numbers, 52% of the actual number, you'll see that with 42,000 suicides, you already have more people dying of firearms suicides than you would have of all homicides in 2014. That's an extraordinary observation, and it so much conflicts with our experience and what you're reading about and hearing generally in the public eye, which is that homicide's a really big deal we need to be worried about, when in fact there are about three times as many suicides each year. The number continues to go up. The second thing to say about this, because people never know how to kind of compute a number like 42,000, but just as a reference point, again, in the United States, there were 39,000 breast cancer deaths in 2014. So more deaths from suicide than breast cancer, actually than all forms of cancer except for colon and lung. So rather extraordinary how serious this set of issues is as a public health problem, which is what President Kennedy said over 50 years ago. It's also incredibly expensive, the other point that he made. And this is an analysis that came out just towards the end of last year and shows that when you look, in this case going back to 2013 spending, that mental disorders are actually the leading source of spend. In this case, it broke the $200 billion mark. And that's a real change from where it had been. The expense has gone up, partly driven by medications, partly by hospitalization. And then there are a whole bunch of other issues that are sort of indirect costs, incarceration, homelessness, a whole range of disability services that contribute. So these are really, really big numbers and something we need to think about as we think about the challenge that we can address here. So my summary of this is that for this coming century, these will be like infectious diseases were in the last century. This is going to be the big deal for public health issues. And actually, to put it even more hyperbolically, for social justice. These are really issues that aren't just medical. They're issues about who we are and how we take care of people within our population who are really struggling. Brain disorders generally are going to be the most disabling and the most costly of chronic conditions during this century. And the fact is that we need to both know more and do better across this entire range of brain disorders. And a lot of what you're hearing today and tomorrow is going to be ideas about how to do that. When I think about how we can approach this, I tend to think about a mentor of mine who's somebody who's had a huge impact on me, Sidney Brenner, who once said that progress in science depends on new techniques, new discoveries, and new ideas, and importantly, probably just about in that order. So I want to take you through how we think about these issues, starting with new techniques, what that would mean in terms of new discoveries, and then maybe new ideas that would emerge. We'll do it very quickly, just to give you kind of a sense of really what I would call three different revolutions that have taken place in the last decade. And each one of them has, I think, different implications for how we can address the morbidity and mortality problem for severe mental illness. We can start with genomics, just to sort of capture what I mean by revolution, you can see here, in terms of the changes in technology, the ability to go towards sequencing cheaper and faster than we could have even imagined a decade ago. Really quite striking, from $22 million per genome down to about 2,000 or even less at this point. But most importantly, from something that took essentially years to now hours. So this is an extraordinary change. The other piece of this is actually more of a cultural change, that we've been able to now amass large groups of DNA sets, and we have people working together across institutions, across countries for the first time. The Psychiatric Genomics Consortium is a great example. It was formed in the last decade. 800 individuals from over 30 countries working together, sharing DNA, sharing clinical data. And the result of that is we've actually gotten some discoveries out. You can see examples. Just as the consortium took off, you can see how in about 2008, we started to see really big increases in gene discovery. And that was particularly apparent for bipolar and schizophrenia. Those numbers are probably already out of date, though they were just published 6 months ago. But you can see this is now a rapidly growing area, and we are beginning to get some new interesting insights. Just as one example in a review paper done last summer, Andrew Plummer laid out many of the genes that seem to be giving us the biggest effect sizes or odds ratios. And one, I don't know how well you can see this, the little yellow boxes are different disorders as identified by DSM-4 or DSM-5. And you can see that apparently nature forgot to read that book, because so many of the genes that are popping up are for multiple disorders, which is why you have really a spider web here that crosses over in so many places. So it seems to me that the ideas that we have so far from this last decade, which is moving so quickly, and will probably be very different in the coming decade, is that we can say that the genetics of mental illness is not what we thought it was a decade ago, where we thought we'd have a few big discoveries like in cystic fibrosis or Huntington's disease. Not the case. Even for autism, where there are a few, they're very few. They explain only a small part of the variants. For schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, especially for depression, we're talking not about genes that cause the illness. We're talking about genes that really simply load the gun. These are genes for risk, and they often confer, each one of them, a very, very small amount of risk. That's just another way of saying that the genetics of mental disorders is going to be very complex, not simple. I think the one thing we can say, when we begin to map out those hundreds of genes that are now emerging from the studies that have been done, is that they do tend to tell a story. It's early days, but the story they tell is the story of brain development. It's telling us that the genetics of risk, or the genetics of how brains get built, how they get wired, how brain wiring responds to the world out there, and how it adapts. So it's beginning to emerge, but it's a far more complicated story, not yet actionable in any way that we've been able to identify. But it's certainly been, I think by any account, a revolution in terms of increasing insights, increasing discoveries, still much to be done there. Let's talk about neuroscience, and you've just heard from Miguel, so I don't need to reiterate a lot of this, but this has been, again, an extraordinary period where we're seeing these enormous changes in what we're able to do, even for human neuroscience, which is way, way behind where we are for animals. Perhaps one of the most interesting things, again, is in our ability to culturally bring large data sets together for the first time. So you aren't looking at individual labs, but you're looking at labs that have combined information, combined studies, so that we have, for the first time, thousands and thousands of scans to begin to mine, rather than the handful of scans that we had in years past. The other piece of this is being able to move to different kinds of analytic strategies, which I think is really going to change the way we can think about this area. The Human Connectome Project, which is just completed, 1,200 controls, a little bit like the Human Genome Project, asking the question, what does normal variation look like across multimodal imaging, using all of these state-of-the-art methods with very extensive phenotyping, so cognitive testing, a lot of behavioral testing, huge amount of information, all in the public domain, funded by taxpayers through the NIH blueprint, and is now something that I think will help to inform much of what we can learn about. I thought I'd just point to one really recent paper, which is, I think, a picture of what we can begin to expect as the human connectome studies begin to emerge, especially around resting state. It's a project that actually, I believe, started here at Stanford in the Department of Psychiatry when Connor Liston was a postdoc not that many years ago, about 6 years ago. But the basic idea here was to do an enormous amount of imaging in a group of patients that were going to go through an RTMS, that's transcranial magnetic stimulation protocol for the treatment of depression. And these are very complicated images, so I won't take you through all of it. Simply to say that as one looks at the resting state imaging across a whole group of people with depression, they began to see four different clusters. They ended up calling these biotypes. And all of a sudden, a group of patients that look relatively similar in terms of meeting the criteria for major depressive disorder look like they have probably four different disorders. And to support that, when they went into the clinical trial, what they discovered was, ooh, and I hope you can see this. I'm not sure I've got a pointer here. But in that, the first bar graph on the right, you can see that each of the biotypes gave quite different responses to the transcranial magnetic stimulation, depending on what circuits in the brain were implicated. So this is breaking down major depressive disorder by looking at brain circuitry and beginning to define this as a brain disease, the neural basis, leading to these conclusions in terms of what we can say about what we now know and how we can think about these disorders. That, in fact, we can talk about mental disorders as brain disorders, something that we've been doing for a while, but without a real understanding or a real grasp of what that would mean. What it means is that these are disorders of circuits, and our ability to measure circuits and monitor circuits before and after treatment, be able to take a large group of people who may ostensibly look like they have the same disorder and yet have very different circuit activation patterns. It's a little bit analogous to where we are for breast cancer today, where we know now that breast cancer is probably 12 different illnesses depending on the molecular pathology. Even though the tumors look identical, and they may even look identical at the micro level, at the molecular level, strikingly different, and they require different treatments. This is precision medicine for depression, that we can begin to figure out what circuits are involved. And then we can use imaging in this way to break down the diagnostic types that we have currently and to get much, much better about understanding who should get which treatment. Actually, this is a big issue for us because I think one of the things that's held back the field when we ask ourselves at Verily, like, why have we failed so badly in 5 decades? Why haven't we bent the curve? Part of it, I think, is on the diagnostic side. And you see this was the same conversation happening a decade ago in oncology when people began to realize, yes, we had to get more precise diagnostics to get better outcomes. In the case of major depressive disorder, pretty good example. Even the new DSM says it's 5 out of 9 features for 2 weeks, so you can't attribute to something else. But we have actually no biomarkers to get any better than that. There are no objective measures beyond what we can obtain in a clinical interview. If you just do the math, so 5 out of 9 means that there are 256 different ways to meet those criteria. And that also means that if you had 2 people, both with the same, could have the same diagnosis, and yet they only share 1 out of 9 criteria, diagnostic criteria. So 1 out of 9 is not great. And one would expect that maybe we can do better than that. It's probably one reason why getting this diagnosis doesn't really tell you very much about what treatments would be indicated. I like to say, although I've gotten a lot of flack for this, that it's actually very useful for billing. It's good for reimbursement because you can get reliability. I'm old enough to remember before the DSM era when it was just totally chaotic. Now we have some agreement, at least. Everybody can say, oh yes, there are 5 out of these 9 criteria that are present. Bingo, you get this label. It doesn't mean anything. It doesn't really help you. And it doesn't get you to a deeper understanding of the underlying biology. Why else? Well, we've had problems, I think, with the whole so-called system, the whole mental health system, which really does not work very well. In fact, many, many people would say it's not a system at all. So even if you take the 10 million people with serious mental illness, what you find is only about 40% of them are getting treatment at all. Of those, maybe a third are getting a treatment that you would say has any scientific basis to it, and about a third of those will show full recovery as a result. Another third will show some benefit, but a lot are still not responding to the treatments we have. Lots of issues about this. One is that there simply aren't enough providers, at least providers with the adequate training. And SAMHSA, which is the organization that, in the federal level, that manages mental health services, claims that over half of the counties have no people to do this. And even where there are therapists and psychiatrists, like in this particular county, for instance, where we have a lot of psychiatrists, about half of them don't accept insurance and more than half don't accept Medicaid. So it's great. We now have mental health parity. That's wonderful. It means that you have to have insurance coverage for mental health care in the same way you have for physical health care, except that it turns out the clinicians don't accept it anyway. So it doesn't really help you to get the care that you might need for a loved one. This is a tough situation to be in, and there are sort of 2 aspects of this. One is to say we probably need better treatments. My own read on this is that we do a lot better if we just make sure that we deliver the treatments that we do know work for a significant number of people and deliver them further upstream. The other part of it is that we have a very fragmented care system. So you've got psychologists, social workers, marriage and family counselors, psychiatrists, primary care docs who do most of the medication. It's a mess, and it's never brought together in a way that has the patient at the center and has a strategy that actually makes sure that everybody's rowing in the same direction, which is, to me, extraordinary. There's, for instance, no common medical record for all of this. There's an enormous delay in getting care. Generally, in medicine, we do best when we get there early. This is an area where we tend to get there late. Depression's one example. 6 to 8 years is the median latency between onset of symptoms and getting treatment, which is not where we'd want to be. In the case of even serious illnesses like schizophrenia, the most recent data is 74 weeks is the duration of untreated psychosis, which is hard to believe. And finally, I call all these the quantity problems. There's also the quality problem that, in fact, most of the workforce doesn't have medical training, something you would never accept for oncology or diabetes. And those that do have sort of training in therapy, even if they're not scientifically or medically trained, aren't getting trained in those very treatments that we know have a scientific basis to them. So we're in an area that's largely unregulated. And unfortunately, if you find yourself becoming what I call an involuntary expert because someone you love has one of these illnesses, what you discover is that what they get often depends on whose door you knock on and not on what they actually need, which again, we would just not accept in any other area of medicine. So, gosh, after Miguel, this sounds like I'm a real downer here, telling you how bad things are, but they are pretty bad. You've got high morbidity, high mortality, very high costs. You need to know that we actually do have pretty good treatments for virtually every one of these serious disorders, but you've got all of these issues, access, fragmentation, delay, the poor quality, and stigma, which means just negative attitudes that keeps people from seeking treatment, and also is one of the things that sort of is baked into many of these illnesses that often precludes them getting a full recovery. So the question for us is whether wearable technology, neurotechnology, whether the things that all of us in this room care about can actually make a difference. I often tell the story that I was at a public meeting a couple of years ago while I was at the NIH talking about all the really cool neuroscience and genomics and epigenomics, and somebody got up at the back of the room. This was somebody who had a 23-year-old with schizophrenia, and he said, "You don't get it." He said, "Our house is on fire, and you're focused on the chemistry of the paint." And so we've been thinking a lot at Verily about, so how do we put out the fire? And I just listed all of those issues that we're struggling with and that seem to be reasons why we haven't been able to bend the curve. And the question is, can this revolution, the technology revolution, which you've heard a lot about already today, have a difference? I'll just give you the numbers that we often think about when we think about what's really happened in the last decade. And they're mind-boggling. I mean, it really is every bit as extraordinary as the genomic story. When you just look at the increase in phones and Facebook and Google searches and apps, the App Store wasn't even around in 2006. So that's how, I mean, when you realize that the iPhone was introduced in January of 2007. So that's all happened in the last decade, this entire world that all of us have come to either detest or fall in love with, and sometimes at the same time. This is all really a recent phenomenon. The other piece of this is the ability to use machine learning, which is really, I think, going to, and we've heard a bit about this, you're going to hear much more, is really going to be one of the great movers and shakers as we go forward. So Vinod will probably talk about this, because these are all products from companies that he has supported, but there's lots of stuff you can do today with smartphones. These are not Verily products, but we have EKG machines. We have this wonderful little adapter. Someone has put on a wonderful adapter on the iPhone that allows you to look in the ear. So if you have a kid with a hot ear or who's just crying and you think maybe they have an ear infection, mom or dad can take a peek in there, send the picture to their pediatrician who can then send the prescription to the local pharmacy. And wow, that is just so much better than having to wait 2 days with a screaming four-year-old to get treated for otitis. So there's a lot happening. That is your favorite iPhone breathalyzer, which maybe would be useful to people for a whole bunch of reasons. But that's the kinds of things that can be developed. The question is, can we develop these in a way that makes a difference for people with depression or PTSD or for any of these other areas? The kinds of things we've been thinking about is what you can do with a smartphone. There are many, many people in this arena right now. We call this digital phenotyping, a term introduced by J.P. Onella about a year ago. The idea being that we can pick up all these raw data sources and turn them into behavioral labels and then use those in some ways as derived clinical insights to be able to get continuous, objective, passive measures of behavior. It's kind of weird that in a set of disorders where you know the fundamental problem that somebody has with depression is very low self-esteem and an inability to know when the glass is half full, because it's always half empty when you're depressed, what we do to ask how people are feeling is only rely on subjective measures. Now, that is essential to get their subjective assessment, but often their behavior is changing before they realize it. They're starting to sleep better. They're starting to get out more. They're starting to use their phones more for social connectivity, and they don't even know it. So how valuable it could be to get a more objective and continuous measure. The other thing about this is that we ask people every 2 weeks, or in the case of primary care, every 4 weeks, how you doing after you go on a medication. And what we find out from that is how they've been feeling in the previous 2 to 3 hours. What we don't know is how they were feeling at 3 o'clock in the morning, or how they were feeling in a long, lonely weekend, all of which is the importance of keeping these continuous measures. In fact, if you think about it, it's kind of interesting. Each one of those issues that looks like a barrier, access, fragmentation, delay, each of those can be addressed with tools we have, not even fancy technology. I mean, just really straightforward things that are already on your phone, or the kinds of things that aren't that difficult to put together. So we've been thinking about how to build something like this and create opportunities that allow more of those people who are not in treatment to get engaged, because, by the way, you can have an anonymous source, so it takes care of some of the issues around stigma. It can be available 24/7, so you've got that kind of access that's not available when you have only in vivo connections. And we can even address the quality issues, because we can make sure that the interventions as they're deployed online actually match scientifically what is really best for any given individual. And you put all that together with the ability to have measurement-based care. Really important in this field that people do not measure treatment outcomes the way they do in diabetes or hypertension. And we can begin to do that. And we could do it in a way that would be passive and continuous, along with subjective measures, which are also important, but be able to give us for the first time a far more rigorous picture of how people are doing. Just thought I'd give you a couple of insights without going deep into any of these issues. Mental Health America asked a lot of people to fill out these screens. And you can see they had up to almost, well, over 800,000 people screened positive for depression. This was being done online. And then they asked them, what do you want? What are you looking for? And what they discovered was that less than 25% really wanted to go someplace for treatment. Most people wanted either more information or they wanted to get some help online, something that was built around their needs and not the needs of a therapist. Another example of the kinds of things that are now just standard, crisis text line. I mean, it's incredible to me that we hadn't done this before, but this is for anyone anywhere, at least in the United States, 741741 connects you to a crisis coach within 90 seconds. The average engagement time there is about 50 minutes. There have actually been, now it's the number's up to 30 million texts that have been shared back and forth since 2013. And an opportunity, again, for 24/7 coverage. Anybody, anywhere can have somebody on the other end of their texting pipeline to be able to respond to an issue that they're struggling with, including calling in an active rescue, which happens more than once a day. Actually, we're up to about, I think, 3,000 active rescues. And now building machine learning into this. Interesting story, actually. Nancy Lublin, who was here a couple of weeks ago, talked about this, how the using machine learning, they've been able to get very good at predicting who's going to need an active rescue. And you might think that the word suicide in a text from a 17-year-old would say, whoops, that's the time to call 911. In fact, the word suicide was not predictive of needing an active rescue. The word ibuprofen was the number one prediction of that. It was usually in the context of what is a lethal dose of. There are some important insights that we begin to get when you get lots of data and you take away many of your assumptions that may be helpful. Danielle Schlosser, who's here and did this when she was at UCSF, she's now part of the team at Verily, developed a really interesting app with the IDEO team that also had a real surprise for many of us. She targeted a young psychotic individuals after their first break. A group of people who you might think would not be particularly interested in being monitored with their smartphones or engaged with their smartphones because their world is so chaotic and they are so cognitively disorganized. And yet, amazingly, this worked really well. In fact, the engagement she was able to get was somewhat better than what we've seen with many, many other populations. The secret here seems to be that this is, again, built around the needs of kids in this situation. So this wasn't about what are your hallucinations are like, or it wasn't asking them, are you feeling suicidal? It was saying, how can we help you get a date? How can we help you reach out to a friend? How can we help you explain this to your parents? Really going after the very things that these kids really cared about, and they engaged. And in fact, the clinical outcomes are really pretty spectacular. And the wonderful thing here is that it's being tracked at the same time so that you have, again, measurement-based care with a foundation of both peer support and coaching, all of which is done online. So it scales very quickly. There's a huge amount going on here, and without delving deeply into any of it, I thought what would be useful would be just to sort of, because you'll hear much more about this, not only at this conference, but lots of other places, try to give you the kind of overall context, the way I think about this after spending about 18 months now trying to really get my hands around this area where there's some thousands and thousands of apps and lots of other stuff. To me, there are three buckets to think about. There's the digital phenotyping stuff that I mentioned. That's taking these passive measures off of a phone where you get sleep, voice, activity, sociality, cognition. Pretty straightforward, pretty interesting. Lots of people have shown that it's feasible. We still don't know if it's actionable or whether it actually changes outcomes. And I think we have a lot more to learn there. Early days. So I think it's too soon for the jury to report out, but hopefully we'll know much more about this over the next couple of years. Mobile interventions, that's been around for a bit. It's getting much, much better. I showed you an example with the crisis intervention of what can be done for crisis text line, peer support, and coaching, which is what Prime does. That's the one that I mentioned for young people with psychosis. But the whole range of psychosocial treatments that do have a scientific basis, CBT, DBT, IPT, all these things that we know a lot about, they've been around for a couple of decades. We can now deploy them and scale them and provide them to that huge number of people who are not getting high quality care. And then finally, there's this other bucket which we talk much less about, but maybe just as consequential, which is the opportunity to both overcome that fragmentation I talked about in the care by providing tools that can allow you to coordinate care between primary care, families, specialty care, all of that, as well as baking in the measurements. So having measurement-based care is a really huge piece of how we want to go forward with this area. So in thinking about this, I want to stress that it's still early days, and I think there's still major, major questions about the value of what we're trying to do here. In fact, as I think about it, there's sort of two major challenges for us. One is showing that this actually works, that is, that we get better outcomes. I think we're at the stage now where there's a lot of evidence for feasibility. We don't yet have great evidence for efficacy. There are huge problems with engagement. When people get depressed, they don't plug their phones in as often. They just turn them off. They may not use them. So these are issues we really have to think about. And what we've heard a lot from payers and providers is, don't give me more data. I already have more data than I want to look at. Help me with efficiency. Help me with decision support. Help me to get things done faster, better, cheaper. So half of the battle, I think, is that we still need to show that all these cool tools actually do make a difference and save lives. They really do bend the curve in the way we were originally talking about. The second half is maybe even more important, and that is to do this with some trust that gets baked in from the very beginning. To me, that means that you've got to have complete transparency so people know what it is you're collecting and why you're collecting it, and they have control over that. So this is about giving people agency, not about doing something to them. And it's going to be critical that the people in this field act responsibly. We've already had issues where people have put out therapy apps without really looking at privacy, without thinking about what crisis intervention should look like, without really dealing with this as a serious medical, but sometimes fatal set of disorders that they have to be responsible for. So these are big issues that we have to tackle if this area is really going to bend the curve. To me, a kind of simple way to think about this and a way to sort of frame it is to ask whether what we are doing is giving people information that empowers them, both patients and families. And I think to the extent that we can do that, to the extent that this is all about giving people something that they need to recover, or that a loved one needs to recover, that we'll be able to both demonstrate the value and ensure the trust. I sometimes use this as an example. Eric Topol's book, That the Patient Will See You Now, I think is a great example of just flipping the way we think about healthcare and now putting patients at the center, empowering them with information that they can then make decisions about what would be best and in their best interest. So I'm taking you through these three revolutions really quickly. We didn't get to dive into any of them at any great length, but I wanted to give you the sense that in spite of my being the Debbie Downer and telling you all the terrible things that are happening, which is a little bit like our current president seems to be doing way too much, there's actually a huge amount of opportunity with all three of these. And the way that they come together, I think, will be intriguing to watch over the next very, very short time. I'll end with my favorite quote from Bill Gates, where he often says that things will change much less than we think over the next 2 years and much more than we can imagine in the next 10. And I think that is probably pretty much what we're going to see here as well. Thank you.